Okay, so this is the new Windows 8 consumer preview. As you can see, when you boot up and log in, Windows loads you into the new Metro-style start menu interface. First impressions already give away that this OS has design features that will specifically benefit touch devices like tablets, mobile phones, and touchscreen PCs. With the exception of video capture software, and the Windows 7 drivers for my Netgear USB wireless card, I've left this installation pretty much as is, so you can see what Windows 8 is like straight out of the box. I was a bit surprised that my network card wasn't supported after reading that Windows 8 actually has a pretty good database of drivers, and my card is a relatively common monster. This is, however, just a preview release, so not everything is finished and polished to every user's liking, like a final product. Just quickly, Microsoft hasn't entirely changed the interface, so don't stress about having to learn a new system from scratch. Also, if you want the classic Windows 7 feel, you can just switch to the desktop pane down the bottom left here. And this brings up a desktop much like Windows 7, with one notable difference. There's no actual start menu button. However, I have seen other people who have added a start menu icon like in Windows 7 by simply changing their interface settings. But I'm intending this to show the system exactly as it is after installation for the common user. So I'll show people interested how to modify their interface another time. In the meantime, you can still get to the start menu by dropping the mouse down into the bottom left corner and clicking. The corners are the important places you'll be using if you're on a keyboard and mouse in this Windows version. Now, just to guide you through some of the new menu and interaction methods, I'll move back to the start menu by hitting my Windows key on the keyboard. I move the cursor down here to the bottom right where there's a small magnifier app pane. This allows you to zoom out on your start menu, allowing you to see more apps and settings stretched across the screen rather than scrolling from menu slide to menu slide. Mine's pretty empty, so no need for this just yet. If you hold the cursor down just a little lower off the screen, this activates the calendar and clock as well as a menu dock with search, share, start, devices, and settings. This menu is accessible from within any app running on the Metro interface, and it more or less acts as a less specific, more user-friendly file, edit, options, and help menu, like in traditional Windows layouts. It allows you to search within the app, on the local machine, or online, to share information between certain apps, for example Photo Gallery and Twitter. This is really only useful once you've set up your Facebook, MySpace, Twitter, and other accounts. Both of the last two are pretty self-explanatory. Through devices, you can manipulate the devices being used, and settings to update the app settings. Just to give you a quick overview of the new settings features, we'll go to more PC settings. Here we can see how to customize the login or lock screen by changing the picture and selecting what applications can run in the background to show notifications before you log in, like new emails or buddy messages. Under users, you can choose your account type, either a local account to the computer or sign in with a Windows Live account like I have. Now under sign-in options is where we see a real change from the status quo Microsoft. It allows you to create a picture password. This option allows you to use gestures on an image rather than a password to gain access to your account. Choose the picture, draw the gestures. You can use any combinations of circles, straight lines, and taps. Repeat them and you're done. Alternatively, you can create a 4-digit PIN instead. The rest is pretty stock standard and self-explanatory, but I will quickly draw some attention to the recovery feature here under the general menu. There are a couple of wizards here that will help you get back to a smooth Windows experience in the nearly inevitable case that something has gone wrong for you. The first is the Refresh Your PC wizard. This will change your PC settings back to the default and remove applications installed from websites or disks, without affecting your personal files, settings, and apps installed from the market. The Reset Wizard is a bit more thorough and will remove all of your personal files and apps, as well as reverting all settings back to factory default. I've noticed if you just move back to the Home Start menu, then apps get minimized rather than closed. However, they won't show up as an open program on your desktop ribbon. In fact, they are kept completely separate. To see what Metro apps you have left open, you need to hit the Windows button and tab. To close the app, you can either right click on it and select close, or less traditional in a more finger touch style, which will suit tablets and mobile phones better. You can grab the window by clicking down on the top, holding the mouse down until the focus of the window zooms out, and then dragging the window to the bottom of the screen till it shrinks and dims. One feature I haven't been able to get working on my machine is the split view, which is a bit of a shame, as it was one of the key features that I was really impressed with when Microsoft first released a demonstration video. The idea is that you can drag an open app over to the far side of the screen and lock it in so that you can both view and access it and the app or program originally in focus. The search bar has been a bit revamped, as it won't appear unless you start typing. Then it kicks in and searches your installed apps. You can also choose to search through files or settings, or just use it as a run dialog, like so. Okay, so from what we can see here, Windows is operating under DirectX 11. Also, my system specs. It's about a 2.5-year-old machine now, but has no issues running this operating system. Just as a quick side note, Windows 8 also ran excellently on my dual-core Dell Studio 15, so it certainly doesn't require a top-notch PC or a new machine. The minimum recommended system settings for Windows 8 is a 1GHz CPU, 1GB RAM, 16-20GB hard drive, and a graphics card that supports DirectX 9 or above. As you can see, this computer definitely falls within the operational limits of this OS. Back to the apps, and there is one specific difference between the Metro apps and the legacy Windows applications, that is, they aren't necessarily the same. Take for example the two versions of Internet Explorer. The app is Internet Explorer 10, and looks and behaves more like a mobile browser app. It's very slim on UI, and accessible features, smooth and fast. It does not, however, support any ActiveX plugins at this stage, which is a bit of a letdown for a desktop or even a higher-range tablet user. Internet Explorer 9 functions totally as expected, just like it would in Windows 7. I'll just add in here a suggestion that you should only ever visit one website using Internet Explorer, and that is Mozilla.com. Internet Explorer is a magnet for viruses and phishing scams, as well as a minefield of bugs. When it comes to debugging and cleaning up after messy apps, the New Look Task Manager is a great tool and has really impressed me. First off, it spaced everything out and added icons, making life a lot easier when you're sorting through hundreds of applications and processes. Adding an App History tab is probably my favorite feature because it tells you everything you need to know about your application and their behavior both on your system and on your network. Also, adding the Startup tab is a brilliant idea, as in previous versions of Windows, msconfig was the only way to disable troublesome programs at startup. Putting it on the Task Manager is not only time-saving, but also brings it out in the open for more novice users who otherwise mightn't have known about it to use it. The file transfer dialog and protocol have also changed a bit. Finally offering a pause feature during file transfer is something Windows has been sorely lacking and the cause of much frustration for me over the years. Now in the case you are copying or moving large files but need to free up the hard drive or CPU mid-transfer, but don't want to cancel the process, which often takes ages to do in itself, and then start again, you can just pause the process and then continue it at your leisure, thus giving the user much more control of the experience. All in all, I'm pretty impressed with the way this release is shaping up, and am anticipating further testing leading up to the final commercial release, looking to be around 2013 sometime. Anyway, I hope this preview guide part 1 has been helpful and informative. Thanks for taking the time to watch. I'll post part 2 and further reviews as time allows, and I become more familiar with the operating system. Thanks again.